Good day, everyone. I would like to welcome you all to the APRU Sustainable Waste Management Global Lecture Series. I am Amasha Vitana, a PhD scholar at Korea University, and I am going to host this event. Before starting today's event, I would like to invite Paul Park to provide some technical instructions for the webinar logistics for the attendees.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being with us in the 8th session of Global Lecture Series. As Amasha mentioned, I'm going to collaborate with the webinar logistics today. Here are some recommendations to consider during the event. This is a webinar mode, so you can listen and see the panelists and is possible to interact through the following tools. We have enabled two chats. You can ask questions to our speaker or panelists anytime through Q&A chat and on the general chat. You can leave some comments or share important information. If you're interested to talk and ask a question, please raise your hand and I will unmute you so you can interact directly with the panelists. As it is an international event, we kindly ask you to use the English name all the time. Besides, if you have any problem or issues during the event, please feel free to send a chat to me and I will try to help you. We hope you will enjoy the event. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. APRU Sustainable Waste Management Program Global Lecture Series is organized by the APRU SWM Program, where Professor Yongsi Kok at Korea University serves as the director of the program. The program is co-directed by Professor William Mitch at Stanford University and Professor David Wardley at Nanyang Technological University. Today's lecture will be delivered by Professor Thomas Hojlund Christiansen from Technical University of Denmark. The title of the lecture is The Role of Life Cycle Assessment in Sustainable Waste Management. At the end of the presentation, there will be a Q&A session. So I encourage all the attendees to participate in the event actively and come up with your questions for the discussion. Now, I would like to invite Paul Park to give the welcome address.
Hello, everyone. The APRU Sustainable Waste Management Program, hosted by the Korea University, offers a timely opportunity for knowledge exchange among professionals from all over the world to assist the formulation of an efficient sustainable management agenda for biological waste and remediation of soil, water, and air in the local context, which satisfies the environmental compatibility, financial feasibility, and social needs. Professor Yongsi Kok is the director of APRU Sustainable Waste Management Program. APRU has a membership of the presidents of 55 leading universities from around the Pacific Rim. This includes 2 million students and 200,000 academic staffs. APRU SWM Global Lecture Series is designed to provide a sound foundation in basic principles and unifying research across ecology to conservation and environmental health to waste management while paying more attention to ESG, environmental, social, and governance, and global sustainability. Particularly, some selected topics will be discussed through APRU SWM Global Lecture Series, focusing on key pillar in ESG. The key topics of APRU SWM Global Lecture Series are conservation, ecology, environmental chemistry, environmental health, environmental resource management, sustainable waste management, water science, global sustainability, and life science assessment. As you know, we APRU SWM have consistently tried to carry out a variety of programs designed to accelerate academic activities and international cooperation. APRU SWM Global Lecture Series is a part of the regular range of events offered by the APRU SWM program and is designed to offer the audience an inside view of cutting-edge research topics. I believe the participants will be able to learn from and interact with world-renowned scientists around the world through this lecture series. I also hope that this event will become a valuable opportunity to extend and share friendship among those who participate in the webinar. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. Now, we will move to the 8th lecture of Global Lecture Series. I would like to cordially invite Professor Ali Abbas from the University of Sydney, Australia, to introduce our today's speaker. Over to you, Professor Abbas.
Thank you, Amasha. And thanks for organizing this excellent seminar. It is a great honor for me to introduce our speaker today, who is Professor Thomas Holund Christensen from Technical University of Denmark. Before starting the lecture, I'd like to give a brief introduction about Professor Christensen. Thomas H. Christensen is a professor at the Department of Environmental Engineering at the Technical University of Denmark in Copenhagen. He is honorary professor at Dongji University, Shanghai, and a distinguished visiting professor at Tsinghua University, Beijing, in China. He received his degrees from the Technical University of Denmark, Master of Science in Solid Waste, the University of Washington, Seattle, PhD in Water Chemistry, and the Copenhagen University Doctor Agro in Soil Chemistry. The research interest covers all aspects of waste management, as well as effects of waste on soil and groundwater quality. His recent research focus is on life cycle assessment of waste management systems. He is the founder of the EASTEC model used around the world for LCA modeling of waste management systems. He has served in several research councils, professional societies, and university boards. In 2011, he published the textbook Solid Waste Technology and Management. Over to you, Professor Christensen, and I'm looking forward to hearing your talk today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for all these words. It was really too much. It's a great pleasure for me to be able to speak to you today, and I'll right away start sharing my screen. And I hope this works, and I hope that somebody will tell me if it doesn't work or if I'm not clear enough in the voice.
It's working good, and we can hear you clearly. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll speak about LCA in sustainable waste management. And what I'm going to be covering the next 40 minutes is first starting out with a little introduction to LCA. I assume many of you know what it is, but related to the waste issues. Then I would like to talk about the things we have learned from using LCA in waste management over the last 20 years. That's about the time horizon we are dealing with. And then I would like to deal with some topics that is relevant for LCA today and in the near future. And finally, at the end, I hope to have time to add a few perspectives about the future a little further away, what that would mean in respect to LCA. So this is what I have planned to do. A lot of the things I'm going to be saying is also found in a paper that I published with a range of colleagues last year, shown at the bottom of the slide. So you might want to go back and read that in case you want further details. Okay, introduction to LCA. First of all, I would like to say that LCA stands for life cycle assessment. So the A is not analysis, as being interpreted many places. It is an assessment. It's a holistic approach that was introduced in the 1990s for assessing the environmental aspects of industrial products. One of the classic examples in textbooks is the one of containers for milk, beer, and soft drinks, and how you evaluate tin cans and glass and paper cartons, and that was really one of the first classic examples that is known around the world. A classic product LCA takes its starting point in the production of the product that we're interested in. But to produce that product, we need to acquire a lot of semi-products, materials, and they all come with a kind of a rucksack from the raw materials that they have extracted, produced the semi-products, and then it goes into the production facility where it's being combined into a product. And after that follows a relatively linear flow of activities such as distribution and sale, the use phase, maybe there is a maintenance phase, and then finally there is the waste disposal phase. So this is the classical setup for product LCA. When you have done that, then you put your boundaries and say, okay, this is what we're going to be studying. And then you go in on each of the processes, on the technologies, and start quantifying what are the inputs to that one in terms of materials and electricity, energy, whatever it is, and what are the emissions from the process. And you do that for all of them. In the beginning, there was a lot of uncertainty about how much you should do about the waste disposal, because the main issue was to compare different materials and different ways of producing them. And waste disposal was really very complicated. And in the early days, it often ended up in like something like kilogram to landfill. And all of you who are interested in waste management know that life is much more complicated than just describing how much in terms of kilograms are put into a landfill. When you've done this for each of these phases here, then you get the sum of them in terms of inputs and outputs. And this is what we call the life cycle inventory. So it quantifies all the exchange emissions. And this can be hundreds or thousands of numbers in a big Excel sheet. On top of that, you put in impact assessment, where you're aggregating all these emissions and exchanges into impacts. And that could be global warming, acidification, and the things that we are really concerned about. So this is how you get an estimate of the environmental profile of this specific product. When you do it for a new product, this part here will of course change because these phases will be different, but the impact approach will be the same. And that allows you to compare different technologies and different products. In waste management, LCA came in the very late 90s. I started in Sweden, in the UK, and the USA. I think this one down here is one of the first papers describing how you should do things. And by 2020, there were more than 400 scientific papers published around LCA and waste management. And the majority of these have been out the last 10 years. So this is a topic that has gained a lot of interest, and not only from the scientific community, but also for a lot of practical purposes and political purposes, as you will see later. Waste LCA differs from product LCA in the complexity of the system. And let me try to illustrate that. You see some similarities with the other one in terms of there are some upstream things in terms of waste types that we're dealing with. Then we have a collection system. And then we have a whole network of treatment facilities that do different things, including maybe landfilling. And finally, over to the right, we get some recyclables or energy that we put out into society. The main point here is that this part here is much more complex than it is in a typical product LCA. And actually the major effort we put into waste LCA is to get this network in a correct way. This is just an illustration, but maybe we could add a few more words. Assuming this, for example, was household waste, and this was a source separation into maybe the food waste from the households, and that food waste goes into a sorting plant where they remove the impurities. The impurities will go to an incinerator. The organic matter will go to a digester. And when you have digested the material, you separate it again, and the solids will go to the incinerator. The liquid will go to a facility that treats the liquid and maybe produce a concentrated liquid to be used as fertilizer. And maybe the gas, you upgrade that to natural gas quality and you put it into the grid. So you can see there are a lot of links, and this means modeling these flows here is essential to get a good basis for a LCA model in waste management. And this is why I would say it's more complicated than doing a product LCA. At the end, you get the inventories in the same way as you do with the other ones. And on top of that, you convert it to impacts. While this part down here is specific for the waste management system, the impact approach is similar for whatever you do. And that of course makes sense because it's the same things we want to protect and avoid. And therefore we shouldn't have different systems, different approaches for different topics. So this is a little about what we're doing in the waste management in terms of LCA. As I said, we have been doing this for about 20 years, most within the last 10 years. And what have we learned from that? And I think there are six learnings. One is that we learned to use more system thinking. We have obtained a lot of detailed technological data about waste management technologies. We start understanding time horizons much better. We start understanding recycling much better than we did earlier. And we understand exchanges with the energy system, which in parts of the world is extremely important. And finally, we start understanding the importance of waste composition. I would say the latter one maybe not be a general understanding, but this is what I think we should understand more of in, from the LCA. And when I say the LCA has given us this, of course, doesn't mean that only LCA has contributed to that, but LCA has helped in developing these aspects here, which are crucial in waste management. So I will now say a few words about each of these six here in the next slide. Waste management took its organized start. That doesn't mean we didn't collect the waste and things before, but in terms of the technologies in the late 60s, maybe in the 70s, and there were a lot of focus on technologies. And around the world, there were very few technologies. Landfilling, incineration were the dominant, or maybe composting. But there was no understanding really on the system level. And we had many discussions, what is best? Should we landfill or should we incinerate? There were very few scientists at that time, and there were a lot of businessmen wanting to sell technologies, membranes, incinerators, whatever they were. The environmental arguments were used, but they were without much quantification. It's much better to recycle nutrients back to agriculture through composting than it is to get electricity and things like that. And there was really no way to sort these arguments. There was also very little understanding of the different waste types could not necessarily enter into all of the technologies. You will know that there are many waste types that doesn't make sense that you compost them, right? But it was a pretty rude and simple discussion. Very little understanding of the flows. Of course, if you only have landfilling, then there's just one flow. But when we started then in the late 70s, 80s to start doing more recycling, there are much more flows in the system. I think the LCA has forced us to think on a system level. And really, today you can only solve waste management issues on a system level. You cannot do it with single technologies. And for the LCA guys, this is really what you work on when you're setting up your goal and your scope, your functional unit and your reference flows. This is where you define what it is that you're going to be comparing and looking at in your system. The other one is technological data. We very often have been starting out on doing LCAs for different cities or regions or countries. And we have always been met with the statement that, yes, we have the data that you want to use for the LCA. Then when we got into the details, we realized that was not really the case. There were a lot of data on mass in terms of measurements on large scales where there has been some kind of payment that you had to take care of. But that really is not enough when you want to do a life cycle inventory. You need mass balances on each technologies, you need energy budgets, and you need emission accounts. Actually, those of you who have an engineering background, this is what you need for all kind of engineering in the waste management system. So this is information that is useful beyond the LCA also. Since we should establish these LCIs, we had to do a lot of measurement, and over the last 10 years, the amount of detailed data available on waste technologies has increased dramatically. And this is because we need to be able to do all flows in and out. We need to focus all components and compounds. It could be waste papers, for example, and all the processes that are involved. And this is, of course, is what leads up to the fact that we can do the life cycle inventory. So I would say, even if you were not interested in the LCA, the fact that we had to go down this road has given us so much more data about the technologies that is relevant in many, many contexts. The third one is the time horizon. In the LCA, those of you that are into that, there are probably three time horizons that you have to define. the time horizon for which the technology is valid. And in many cases, this is around 30 years, because if you're going to start installing new technologies, incineration plants, something like that, you would assume it has a lifetime of maybe 30 years. And therefore, your assessment should cover that period also, because you made the investment and you need to have these two things to fit together. Then there are the time horizons of the emissions from the system. And how long are you going to follow the emissions from a system? If you have an instantaneous combustion of things, then the emissions are very, you know, short term. But if you have a landfill, you can run into hundreds of years of emissions. And the last one is the time horizon for the characterization of the emissions. The global warming potential over 100 years or 20 or 50 years, there are many different approaches. The last one is a general one in terms of the impact assessment, while these two definitely affect the way we are approaching the waste system. And this reminds about likely changes over the time horizon that we're looking at, the waste input. I don't think that the waste input we had in the 1990s is the same we have in the 2020s, and therefore the way that the system will act on the waste input will change as the waste input is changing. Equally complex is the change of the exports over the boundaries or imports. That could be the electricity that we use or we produce in the system. It doesn't have the same environmental rucksack today as it had 30, 40 years ago. So there are some complex aspect here. And in particular, if we go into landfills and ash disposal sites, we are struggling both in terms of finding data, because who have data for gas and leachate amounts and quality for 100 year period? I don't think anybody have, maybe we have for 40, 50 years. What about the residual carbon left after 100 years? What about the toxicity left? And what about the effects on groundwater if the membranes do not last for 100 years? So this becomes very complex when we're going to look into 100 year period, which is a very often length, a very common length of the time horizon. Some of you may know that if you talk about ash disposal, for example, the fly ashes from incinerator, the leaching potential of these disposal sites run into hundreds of thousands of years. And that, of course, shows us that there are maybe even time horizons that go beyond what the LCA is addressing. So this is both challenging our knowledge about the to get the data, but also challenges the ability of our models to do these things here. So this is a little complicated, but I think it has forced us to think about these things, that things do not just disappear. So those were three. The fourth one is that we understand recycling today much better. I think we have learned that all waste management itself is a load to the environment due to the process emissions from treating the waste and the materials energy that we use. The benefits come from the materials, energy and nutrients that we deliver to the surrounding society and which avoid production and use of other products. This is so banal, but it took me, I have to admit that, many years to realize that, and not until we actually did the modeling did I fully understand that. Example is that in many countries around the world, composting has been considered recycling, but you know, it's not the process that's a recycling. Maybe the product could be considered a recyclable product if it substitutes from other soil amendments. So you produce the compost is not recycling. Using the compost instead of something else is where the recycling matters. The same with the material recycling, because here quality matters for what is substituted. And the lower the quality of the material that you provide from the waste management system, the less valuable is the substitution. So paper recycling and paper substitution is not one thing, it is many, many, many different things. And downcycling is, of course, contributing, but it's not recycling as such. You cannot assume that all the paper qualities you get out of a sorting facility would substitute for high quality paper. The issue we also learned here, which is a little hard to accept, is that when this aspect up here is so important. It extends the responsibility of the waste management beyond their own businesses. And of course, that is difficult. So it's not enough just to say it's being recycled. You have to say how it's going to be recycled and what it is that it's substituting. Let me illustrate the issue here. This is a recycling center, not a specific one. And many years we quantified the degree of recycling with how much we fed into the recycling center. In the EU, goals on recycling have been focused on tons of percentages of waste going into the recycling center. But from a system perspective, this is really not the key value. Maybe you should look at what comes out and not on the input, because in this recycling process, you will remove some impurities and you will have a lesser mass coming out as your main product. So maybe you should focus on the output. But what really is important is what does this output substitute? And this is where you get your value. So running the statistics here may not necessarily show you the value of what you're doing. And this is what quality is indicating, that has to be included here, not only build it on masses. And I think we are getting there today, and the statistics now are much more focused on this part here than it was 5-10 years ago. And this, of course, leads to all the issues in LCA about which external databases are we using for material energy substitution. And one good rule here, I think, is certainly to follow the value chain. If the compost doesn't have much value, then it may not have much substitution either. So I think it has helped us in understanding recycling much better. The other thing we have learned is understand the exchange with energy system. LCA has taught us, at least in the Western world, that waste contains a lot of energy. One ton of waste in Denmark has a heating value comparable to 200 liters of diesel. So it's a lot of energy. And the value for the electricity, heat, and fuels that we're producing, it depends on what we're substituting with, and also, therefore, where we are in the geography. The issue is that the energy system is changing dramatically this year. Yeah. And here I have five energy systems. This is a natural gas-based, and here it becomes greener and greener. And over here, it is wind offshore, as we are installing a lot of in Denmark. And you can see that the electricity footprint in terms of kilograms of CO2 per kilowatt hours produced is about 0.4 here. If you use coal, it's about 1 or 1.2 out here, but I didn't include that because I think at least in part of my world, it's more or less gone. And you see it becomes cleaner and cleaner. And there's about a factor of 20 between the natural gas-based and the wind power-based. Similar on heat, where slightly different sources of the energy, but in terms of kilograms CO2 per megajoule, it's 0.07, but here it's 0.01. So there's a factor of 70 between these two here. And of course it matters in our waste management system if we use energy or we are producing energy, because the value of that will fall as time goes. And with all the focus on reducing climate change impacts by reducing the fossil-based energy system, we are in the process of going down here. And that means what we are exchanging with the energy system will change over the next 10, 15, 20, 30 years. And definitely most countries believe they should be here by 2050. And that's within 30 years. So this is extremely important. And I think the LCA has contributed to our understanding of this here. The dynamics in the value of substitution is crucial, but still sometimes overlooked. Okay, the last one I have here, which as I indicated at the beginning, maybe not everybody are agreeing on at this point in time, but I think we will in the future, is the importance of waste composition. Some of the models that are used in waste LCA comes from product LCA, and they are not very good in representing the waste in terms of its composition, and therefore they are not very good in estimating the consequences of changes in the waste composition. But it is a fact that the waste will change, and is different in different regions, and we need to pay attention to that. This also means that not all technologies are equally suited for all waste compositions. I think the example we have is some of the wet Asian waste is less suited for incineration. I won't say that the LCA taught us that because also practice taught us that, but I think the LCA clearly showed what was the problem, and that was this the high water content of a lot of the Asian waste. And this also means in terms of regulating waste and expecting a certain performance, you need to pay attention to the waste composition. And this is often overlooked, but I think LCA showed us that waste composition affects the output from your analysis. Okay, this was a little tour down what I think we have learned over the last 20 years. System thinking, detailed technological data, understanding time horizons, understanding recycling, understanding exchange within the system, and hopefully also understanding importance of waste composition. Now we could say, okay, we have done more than 400 studies published in scientific literatures, and there are much more studies outside the scientific literature. We have learned these things. Why should we go on doing LCA on waste management? And I think there are six reasons for doing that, and I will run through them over the next minutes here. One is LCA is extremely important in understanding an existing waste management system. It's also extremely important if we want to improve it, because we can predict what are the benefits of doing this and that before we actually implement it. It's also very good in comparing alternative technologies or how technologies perform. If we're going to go out and buy a new incinerator, which one should we take? It's also useful in technology development, because when you develop technology today, there is a request from investors and decision makers that you have to prove it's contributing to sustainable development. It's also important in policy development and strategic development. What should we do in the future? Because we can actually model the consequences of potential decisions before we actually implement them. And finally, I think it will also come in as a reporting issue, because with all the focus on climate change and mitigation, there are a lot of companies and cities that will have to report what they do in the future. So I'll add a few words to this here, not going into too much detail, but illustrate a little for you what it is that LCA does in these six areas here. Understanding an existing waste system. It's extremely important to understand your own system, because that teaches you where you should maintain focus on doing well and where you maybe can relax a little more. This is an earlier one from China in Hangzhou, which is a very big city southwest of Shanghai. And there the waste management system was investigated in the early 2000s, and they reported on nutrient enrichment, on global warming, on photochemical ozone formation. This is a smog precursor, acidification and ozone depletion. So these are the impacts, and the loads are, the positive numbers are loads to the environment, and the negative numbers are savings. The unit used over here is a personal equivalent, which is a commonly used term within LCA, and it depends. One person equivalent is the load from one person in average in 1 year based on all the activities in life like food, housing, transport, clothing, etc. within these different ones impact categories. So when you divide with that, then you get an indication of the size of these impacts in terms of how many people would this compare to. This is of course an approximation, but I think it gives you a indication of the level, and it also potentially give you a chance to compare different impact values for different impact categories. There are 4 or 5 million people living in this area, as I remember from the investigation, and you see the person equivalence is running into 100,000, 150,000. So we could not say that waste management is the major environmental issue in the Hangzhou area based on this analysis here. what it shows that the smog precursors is a significant issue of the waste management system. The landfills are contributing a lot to that. The transfer station and the MRFs, the material recycling facilities, and also the collection and the transport is contributing that. The savings come from the material recycling and from the energy recovered from the incinerators. Global warming is also significant. Here is the landfill that is low due to the methane emissions. It's the material recycling that is the saving, and the incinerator is also saving there due to some of the energy that it saves. And the saving, of course, come from the fact that you don't have to produce this energy in a coal-based power plant, which was the alternative when this study was made in the Hangzhou area. So I think this gives you some insight into what is important. I would say this picture of the collection and transport being significant surprised me a little when I read this paper here, because when we do these studies in Northern Europe, this usually doesn't come out. And this, of course, is related to the fact that there are very strict exhaust emission on collection vehicles in our cities, and that was not the case in this city back in 20 years ago. So maybe this could tell you that you have to pay attention to this also. But it's always good to know your system, no matter where you are. This is a little more complicated one, which is from Russia. And get concerned about the detail. It shows a lot of different impact assessment, climate change, freshwater, eutrophication, etc., into some of the toxicities. The point we want to make is that the first one in all of these graphs is the current technology, which is a pretty bad landfill, actually. And these are alternative for the futures. And let's just take a little more close focus on this one up here. It's a little blurred, but I apologize for that. But you can see that the existing landfill is a load to the environment due to the uncontrolled release of methane from parts of the landfill. The two first one here are representing a new landfill, and you can see just going from a bad landfill into a new landfill is a significant saving in global warming impacts in terms of kilogram. This is personal experience also. And if you start doing more things like energy recovery through incineration and material recycling, you can see you can improve your values much. This may be a little banal, but I think it in a decision-making process, in a political process, it's important to illustrate, quantify the benefits of going from the current technology, which is not so good, into alternatives. And this could maybe argue that you should invest in more than just a new landfill, but also in terms of incineration and material recycling. So it can be used to predict what are the consequences of doing things further. I come to number three, which is comparing alternative technologies. And this is a study published some years ago about MBT. MBT stands for mechanical biological treatment. And what you do is that you do some sorting on the material, you may be drying some of it, and you make a fuel out of some of it, and some of it you put to a landfill. This is technology that has been used quite a bit in Central Europe. There are many different ways of doing it, but here they looked at 8 different plants, and they did the LCA on each of them in terms of kilogram of CO2 equivalents per ton of waste. And these are the loads from running the plant and emissions from the plant. And these are the savings from the material and from the energy that you can recover from the fuels. And what you can see of these plants, 8 plants that are assumed to be the same technology, that their net values, which are the diamonds here, they jump between minus 100 to minus 350 kilogram of CO2. And if you should now in your city start considering one of the issues, say, okay, maybe I should go for these here because they are apparently the best ones. What they realized in the study was that they were treating the local waste, but the local waste differed. So if they in the model fed the same waste to the same technologies, the results will look like this here. And now you can suddenly see that these two plants here, which are the same as one here, they seem to be better than the other ones based on this waste composition that they now fed in here. So what it shows us is that, first of all, you have to make sure that you feed your own waste composition into the system, and you need to relate to the technologies that can be different even within the same type of technology. So this is a study that could help you in deciding what you want to do if you wanted to do an MBT plant in your area. So I think this is a good example of comparing technologies. This is a different example, and this has a different presentation because here they give you all the impact categories. You see eutrophication, depletion of abiotic resources. I haven't introduced that earlier. Freshwater aquatic ecotoxicity, and they have the units down here. Don't pay attention to that because this takes more time to explain. But they wanted to look at different methods using bioleaching of extracting copper from electronic waste. And there is a full-scale process where you use a pyrometallurgic system. That means a high-temperature system like melters. And they had a reference study showing what were the impacts per kilogram of copper that you recovered in these impacts here. And these are the values. And then they looked at the bio-leaching, which was an experimental system. And there was some uncertainty about how you would scale it up, depending on how dilute you would make your systems and how efficient they would be depending on how dilute. So they used something they called the pulp density. The technicality is not important, but they used 1, 10 and 20%. Then they did the upscaling and then they did the LCA and figured out that the impacts would be these here. And what you can see here is that the values here are much higher than they are over here. So this is probably not the technology you would use if you should do bioleaching instead of other existing technologies. But what it also shows is that the impacts in the bioleaching are all nearly consequently higher than it is from the existing technologies. So this would show you that if this is going to be a future technology for recovering copper from this waste, you have to be able to do much, much better. Otherwise, you will never, from an environmental point of view, be able to compete with the existing pyrometallurgic system. Of course, there are other issues that play a role here. It could be economics, etc. But this is a really good approach to, before you start building full-scale plants, to say, is the new technology more environmentally friendly than the one we have? And I say, in this case, it was not. I want to show you one other one because I'm a little occupied by these things for the time being. This is a study on carbon capture and utilization in incinerator. It's a little complicated, but I'll just walk you through this here because it shows some important things. This is an energy scenario, which is pretty black, you could say. It's based on a lot of fossil fuels. It becomes more and more green. And over here, it's only wind turbines and things like that you have over here. This line here, which is the reference municipal solid waste incinerator, in the fossil-based system, you can see that it's a saving in terms of kilogram of CO2 per ton of waste. You save about 800 kilograms of CO2 by incinerating the waste over here due to the electricity and heat that they're recovering. When the system becomes more green, you save less because the value of what you're exporting is less significant. And here it becomes neutral. And when you go into more and more green system, you get so to speak, less credit in your substitution. And when you're over here, you're definitely into a load in terms of climate change in the incinerator. Here we investigated the possibilities of making chemicals out of the carbon that was present in the system. By capturing the carbon, adding hydrogen that we obtained from splitting water, making chemicals like methanol, methane, dimethyl ether, or formic acid. This is if we are able to also to make use of the byproducts. And this is if we want to make fuels out of it. But what you can see here is that in the fossil energy system, it doesn't make sense to start catching the carbon dioxide and the off gases from incinerator and making chemicals and fuels out of it, because the loads goes into 3,000 to 5,000 kilogram of CO2 per ton. But you can see as the energy system becomes greener and greener, and we still are substituting for fossil fuels and fossil chemicals, you can see it becomes more and more attractive. So this shows that this can be used as an analysis of developing the technologies here. but it also shows the importance of seeing the technology in the right energy context, the right energy scenario. So maybe in the future, when the energy system becomes green, then it makes sense to make fuels and chemicals out of catching the CO2 from the incinerator. But if you're over here in a fossil system, it certainly does not make sense. Okay, a few more cases, the policy development, and I have chosen a somewhat complicated example here, which is about prevention. And this is a Italian study where they want to look at the packaging of pasta and breakfast cereals and rice, used a lot in Italy. And they have all the impact categories over here. Here are the units. And here they have done the study for the current way of packaging these materials here. And then they have alternatives. Alternatives could be in larger bags, bags of different materials, or in loose weight where you actually fit it to your actual needs. And this is the percent change of the alternatives relative to the baseline. And what you can see is that the alternative one is not really a very good alternative. These ones here have improvement because they are reducing the impact. And over here, it's a kind of a mixed system. It's not a very clear message, except that this is not a good alternative. But you start, when you're having things that are positive and negative, then you have to start prioritizing what matters in the context here. And I think they were a little surprised that it didn't have more consequences than changes between 2 and 10% of the impact from the packaging. But this is what can be done, because a lot of politicians are interested in preventing waste and also consumers. But of course, we need to know what are the consequences before we start introducing a new system. And here the LCA can play a role. The last one, I had a very hard time finding a good example because it really hasn't started. But there are many ambitious companies and utilities and authorities that want to report how well they are doing and how they approach future targets, for example, reducing impact on climate. But in such a complex system, only the LCA can provide an integrated estimate on a targeted impact. One example I found, which is not a reporting in the way that you do it in the future, but was reporting backwards, was a study that looked at 2010 in a city in Denmark, and they found out that the climate impact from the waste management was a saving about 600 kilograms of CO2 per ton of waste due to the energy that they recover in the incinerator. And then they went back and looked, how did we do with the waste in the past? And you can see when they go back to the 70s, when they were using a landfill, it was a load of 600. And this is a way of showing how development from the landfill into better landfill, into incineration, better energy recovery, affects your climate change impacts. And of course, if you have promised that you're going to be down here in 2020, then maybe you need to report the following years how well you're doing. So I think there will be a lot of use of LCA in documenting the climate change initiatives that are being taken around the world. Okay, so I think so far I have argued that there are still six areas where we will use LCA in the future. Understand existing waste management system, improving existing waste management system. I'm sure there are many cases where this will be valuable to do. Whether you're going to publish it or not is another question, because there are so many examples out there that it may be hard to publish them. But going into comparison of technologies or technology development is something that we see a lot coming these years here. And the aspects on policy development, strategic development, and reporting, I think they will come more in the future because we're going to make very dramatic decisions on many levels, and we need to be able to estimate what are the consequences of what we're doing before we do it, because you don't have too many chances to change the system. So I think many of you should consider going into LCA waste management, because there's going to be some work here. Let me just add a few last minutes here about things that are, you know, a little further out. And one thing I already start touching is that energy will be more green, and therefore products, they will also be more green in the future. And this may change what it makes sense to produce within a waste management system. We also see a change in the economy from a linear economy into a circular economy. Somebody even talking about a donut economy. And this means that recyclables will substitute less virgin materials. And therefore, we need to calculate the value of recovering materials in a different way. There will be different shopping patterns, much more internet shopping. There will be different food patterns, at least I see that in my part of the world. And this, of course, is going to change waste management in terms of different waste composition, different technological focus, and also some uncertainty about the substitutional value of what we're producing. And remember, it's only in what we are substituting that we are getting our benefits. Everything else is a load. And therefore, it does matter how much are we getting from what we are substituting. LCA can provide a lot of insight here in terms of potential scenarios with new technologies. So I think there is a great demand for LCA in the future modeling here. But it may be focusing on other things that we have done in the future, both methodological uncertainty handling and also to increase transparency, because we are talking about things that are less defined and maybe less known also. If we go even further into a post-fossil utopia, is it utopia? I don't know, but many countries say they'll be there by 2000 and even some say 2030, many say 2050. So this will have the consequence that many things will have a very low CO2 footprint. It also may have the consequence that biomass for energy production most likely will also be restricted, because there will be demand for food production, for materials and fibers, timber, and also for natural conservation. So just substituting with biomass is probably not going to be the most accepted way. And this means at a certain point that carbon will also be reduced as the fossil carbon is avoided. And carbon may be a valuable component for fuels, plastic, textiles, and certain construction materials. And suddenly, while carbon is the bad guy today, maybe in 30 years, we would like to harvest some of that. The waste has carbon, maybe a third fossil and two-thirds biogenic. And a good place to start could be to start doing carbon capture incinerators, because there you have 400,000 ppm of CO2 opposite in the atmosphere where you have around 400. So it's 1,000 times more concentrated and therefore technologically easier to use for extraction of CO2. I'm not going to go too much into the details, but you can read this later here. But it means that at a certain point, when we start doing carbon capture in incinerators, we may also start producing enough oxygen, because we need hydrogen to deal with the CO2. And the hydrogen comes from splitting of water, and that produces oxygen. So maybe we should start using oxygen for the gas for combustion. And this reduces the flue gases with a factor of 5 to 10, making flue gas cleaning cheaper, provide higher temperatures for energy recovery, and yield a very clean flow of carbon dioxide, pseudohydrogenation into methane, methanol, dimethylate, or formic acid. I know this is a little speculative, but maybe that could bring us there. And this would require then a different incineration plant, an oxy-fuel concept, different steam and heat cycles coupled to hydrogen production, And suddenly the outputs from our system here are different. It may be more fuels than electricity and heat. And then you could argue, why go all the way into oxidation of the carbon and then reducing again? Why don't you use a sub-oxidized system like calcification and pyrolysis? The problem here, of course, is can the products be clean enough? And what is the substitution value of the products? It's hard to tell, because the products that we substitute will maybe also be green. And we may see a complete change in technology products and maybe an LCA approach in the further future. And I think this is a great opportunity for Waste LCA, because it is geared to see different possibilities. I'm just trying to say that it will be different things we'll have to look at in the future that is a little further away. But it certainly shows that there is a room for work on it. So just to conclude, The past gave us much data on waste management. It enhanced our understanding of the system, and it taught us where environmental loads and benefits were in the waste management. At the present, I still think there are these six issues, six areas where you can use LCA, more down here than up here, because we have done that a lot. And in the future, I think there is a use for it with a different approach, because in the long term, energy and carbon management becomes an issue. And we'll have to deal with uncertainties, both in the actual waste management system and in the background system, in a much more elaborate way than we do today. So this ends my talk, and I thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Can I hear you?
Yes. Thank you very much, Professor Christiansen, for the interesting and very informative presentation. I think now we can start a question and answer session. And I believe that there are a lot of questions from the participants as well. So the question and answer session will be led by Professor Ali Abbas from the University of Sydney, Australia. So if you have any questions, you could send your questions via chat function. If not, you may raise your hand so that we can allow you to talk with the speaker directly. Over to you, Professor Abbas.
Thank you, Amasha, and thank you, Professor Christiansen, for the interesting talk. LCA is certainly becoming a much progressed tool being used by many researchers and also, in my research group at the University of Sydney, at the Waste Transformation Research Hub, we extensively use LCA for a variety of different assessments and analyses and different problems. And also, I learned recently that there's quite a fair bit of work being done in non-research areas using LCA to understand the environmental friendliness of some technologies and some investments by investors and non-research organizations. I guess I could ask a first question, please, and we didn't cover that much in the presentation today, Professor Christiansen, and that is, how practical is it to use the LCA or life cycle models developed for solid waste management in one particular country by another country? And in such situations, what are the important aspects that one needs to consider?
That's a very nice question. Thank you. It's always dangerous to directly copy learnings from one setup to another. I think that applies to many, many aspects in the environmental engineering area. I would say that we have done it in many countries around the world. And the first time you do it, it's always a very, very big effort because you really have to dig out a lot of detailed information. When we do waste LCAs, we have a waste composition that has more than 40 fractions, and even each fraction has maybe 40 characteristics in terms of content and things like that. And this is the kind of information that is rarely found in many countries. So I would say you need to have a good information about the waste composition in terms of the materials that you have in the waste. And one tricky thing here is also the water content of the waste, because that is crucial, because what we do in the LCA is we're doing mass flows. And if the water content has not been determined in the right way, then you're getting a wrong system out of it. And it is, and particularly in warm countries, it's not easy to measure the water content of the waste at the right point in the system, because it changes and they exchange between the materials. So that's one thing, waste composition. The other thing is that you have to get a good hold of your technologies. And that's because some of the biological ones, compost and things like, would depend a little on the temperature setup and the humidity, incineration on the technology, landfilling also on temperatures and the way that you actually do it. and the hydrology of this. So you need to have your specific characteristics of the technologies. That doesn't mean you have to start from scratch, because you can borrow from databases, and then you just may need to adjust some of the numbers within the database to get something that is correct. And the last one I was mentioning is that you have to figure out which energy system that you're exchanging with. And that is actually a little complicated, because if you take a consequential approach, which is what we like to do, is then it's not necessarily the average energy system that you're interacting with. Then you have to figure out how does your change in contributing or using energy, how does that change the energy system or the development of the energy system? So in brief, the waste composition, adjustment of technologies, and the energy system is what you need to deal with. But the first time, it's always a lot of work.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thanks for explaining that. Yes, just a reminder, if you've got a question, please raise your hand and we can organize for you to speak directly and speak up your question, or you may also put your question in the chat box. Maybe I can ask another question. If I was just curious about, because a lot of technology is currently being developed for recycling. It's still in the pipeline of development. It's not installed yet. Or there might be one or two recycling facilities around the world, quite novel, quite new, being set up and installed. And if we are looking to compare that type of waste technology, waste management technology, against a benchmark or a base case, how would we go about doing that when we don't have that data for that new technology? Is there a suggestion you can make on that front?
This is a classical problem that we run into. I think there are a couple of things I need to say. One is that when we do an LCA, we are not using optimized data. We should average data for years, because you need to have the down periods and the days where it works less included. And very often when you have new technology, people are reporting the data for the 3 days where things worked perfectly, because this, their ambition should work like that. So in the starting point, there's an uneven basis for comparison, right? So you have to be critical about that. The other thing is that the new technology, they may not have measured everything. They may not have sink included in the emissions, right? So they will not get an impact for sink, while those that have measures think they will get impact, and therefore they will look not as good as the other ones. So you have to make sure that you have compatibility in the LCI structure. And what do you do if you don't have the measurements? Then you will have to assume that they will have to fulfill certain emission standards that are valid, and then just give them that, because they can probably not perform doing worse than that. Maybe they will end up doing better, but then they'll have to prove it. Then you use the emission standards for the different things, emissions to sewers or emissions to air, things like that, so that you get comparable LCIs. So those are the two first tricks. The third one we use is that we start, we use an approach where we don't use single values. We use distributions. And we run through the system, and we do sensitivity analysis, and we figure out which are the critical parameters and processes within the overall performance. And then we look more on the value of the data that are critical. The impact on the results doesn't necessarily depend only on the uncertainty of the parameters, but also on the sensitivity of the parameters. How important are they? So that you can focus on the right ones. And then we make sure that we get a reasonable estimate on how much can this vary. And then you see the consequences if it varies within this interval here. So there are different approaches, but it is a crucial issue to be open about these differences here, so that you don't, because of lack of data, give a favorable evaluation to one technology compared to the other ones. So that's
yeah. Thank you very much for those insights. We do have a question, and this is from Heilong Wang, and thanking you for this excellent talk. Could you please comment on converting waste biomass to biochar, then apply it to soil from an LCA point of view?
Ooh, I'm not sure I am the right one to do that. There are different studies out there, and it may make sense, but I am not sure that it is as good as some people say. We haven't done these things with the biochar ourselves. We have focused more on the carbon capture and the incinerators. I think it depends on what you can use the products for and how long the effects are that you're gonna focus on. I think there will be much more information available with the next 5 years that can support this here. But it's a critical issue. I don't think I would make a final statement on that.
Maybe if I can just, in terms of the structure of the problem, if you are going to recycle, say, the biomass back into biochar, there is a process there. You end up with a biochar product. But here the question is actually interesting because it says, and apply it to soil. So the use of the product afterwards, so the system boundary, maybe if you want to comment on the system boundary, perhaps.
I can do that. I mean, everything you apply to soil makes your boundaries and your time horizon very, very difficult. Even throwing compost on the soil will have effects that ranges into decades in terms of leaching and nutrient availability. And we have done a lot of modeling of that. I think it really, really, really becomes complex. and also with the biochar, how long is this gonna stay in the soil and how much is this gonna affect the nutrient exchanges in the soil? And I don't have a good point of view on that, but that is true that the boundaries on the systems are gonna be different, and you will have to look at the long-term perspectives. And then you have to aggregate the value of them up to your time boundary. And that's not easy.
It's not easy. I think I'm aware of that problem. I think you're also maybe referring to soil carbon. Are you not, Professor Christensen? Soil carbon being quite an important accounting problem these days.
But the biochar will also affect the behavior of some of the other nutrients and the fertility of the soil. And therefore it will affect how nitrogen is moving in the system as well. And that is very complicated. I mean, we have done it not on biochar, but on compost, where there is also a refractory carbon in there. And some in temperate climates, some of that carbon may stay, in fact, it will stay for more than 100 years in the soil and provide you with, when we use your time horizon 100 years, that will actually be a sequestration that you have to consider as being a saving in your CO2. And the biochar could potentially contribute to that, but we need to have these things established. And I have not specifically worked on that, therefore I'm a little hesitant to become more specific.
It is an interesting problem. There is, as I say, quite some activity in the soil carbon space, which I think the LCA will lend a good hand to. But as you say, Professor, we need to understand the mechanisms of that exchange of nutrients and materials. Thank you, Heilong, for that good question. Another question from 186037 is the person asking this question. What do you think about technologies of CO2 utilization to different chemicals in the future? And production of chemicals from biomass. I think you talked about that a fair bit, but
a little, yeah. I think we're going to see a lot of changes in this year because if we want to make our society fossil free, we're going to have an issue about fuels and chemicals. And what we have been looking at into is to produce what we call simple chemicals that can both act as a fuel and as a platform chemical. That means that you can use it in chemical industry to produce other chemicals. That could be methane, methanol, dimethyl ether, or formic acid. And it can be done. I would not say that there are a lot of experience related to waste, but there are in certain other fields, and I think the critical point in this for the next decade is that it takes so much hydrogen because the CO2 has no energy in it, right? It's an oxidized carbon, and you need to reduce that to have the value of a fuel or a platform chemical. And that's the hydrogen that does that. And producing the hydrogen is so energy consuming. When we look at incinerators here, and looked at a couple of incinerators in Denmark, and they produce quite a lot of electricity and heat to the system, and they look good. But if you're gonna catch the carbon dioxide in the flue gas, and you're gonna be converting it into chemicals by adding hydrogen to the compound, you're going to import 10 times as much energy as you're producing. And therefore, it suddenly becomes a different issue because then it's going to affect the energy system. And a big incinerator will require, if you're going to do this by wind turbines, a couple of hundred wind turbines to cover a modern incinerator. So we're talking about big issues here. And you really have to see this in the context of your of other things in the society because it's going to be a major change. But there are two or three cases in the world where carbon dioxide is captured and used as carbon dioxide. I don't think there is at this point in time incinerators or other waste facilities where they're capturing the carbon dioxide and putting it into chemicals. But it's experimentally being addressed.
It is. A lot of people are working on this problem. Yes, the big question many are asking is, what do you do with the captured carbon? Yes, and we'll move on. And Amasha, you have your hand raised there.
Can I just add one thing to that last part before you go on? Is that I think we should start introducing carbon capture, and then we should, for the next period, we should store it underground. We have facilities that can do that, we think. And then when the energy system becomes more green, then you can start utilizing it for chemical production. Not what you pump down, but what your carbon capture facility is producing every year.
Yeah. Utilize, yeah. Over to you, Amasha.
Yes, thank you, Professor. So during the life cycle assessment stages, mainly in the impact assessment and the interpretation stages, does it consider the loss of ecosystem biodiversity? Because every time what we heard is like global warming, potential eutrophication, human toxicity, like the. So does it consider this biodiversity loss of ecosystem biodiversity as an impact for the environment during this life cycle assessment?
How shall I answer that? In the method we use, there is not a specific impact category called ecosystem biodiversity. There are different impact assessment methods. There are actually quite a bit. There are some what they call midterms, and then there are some that called where you go into life expectancies and all those kind of things. And it becomes a little more complicated. And we usually always end up with the midterm because we think that the other ones are a little complicated for the people that we are communicating with, and maybe also for ourselves. I think your concern is whether we are addressing this enough in this system here, and we are probably not. But I don't have a good suggestions on how we do that, except relating to what we already are doing. The overall idea, which I also think is what you're referring to, is that what we don't want to do with the impact assessment is to address things that we are concerned about. I mean, we're not concerned about CO2. We're concerned about climate change, right? And et cetera. And when you go to acidification, you're also concerned about the impacts on forest and freshwaters, and that also is an ecosystem diversity issues. So they are indirectly there, but we don't use an impact category that is specifically addressing biodiversity.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you. Thank you, Amasha. And any final questions, comments? So I guess if we can just wrap up with a final commentary by you, Professor, on your view and experiences on engagements with government and private industry with respect to the LCA work you've been doing. Are they likely to adapt LCA techniques in these industries and the government going forward much more?
It probably depends where you are. I can say that our department has a contract with the Danish EPA, and that has been established because there is a regulation in the Danish parliament that when you come up with regulation with EPA, there should be an environmental assessment about what are the impacts. And we're doing some of that for them every year. Not the very routine ones, because then they have consultants to do that and we don't want to do them. And it does have consequences. Sometimes it has stopped them from doing things in terms of how the recycle, the demands they have to put on recyclability of different things, where our investigation have come showing that this is not major benefit, and then they have dropped it. And there are also other studies where we have pushed it. For example, some of the plywood things where our study have made them, you know, tighten their requirements of wood recycling. So I think the authorities in some countries are interested in doing it. We also have several works with companies. How can I say it? It doesn't always end up in a publishable paper because sometimes they don't like the results and sometimes they're not so favorable as they thought they were. And sometimes they require that we keep it confidential. And we do that in a few cases where we are helping industries to develop their portfolio of technologies. But usually we don't like that it should be kept secret, but there could be, you know, specific thing. So I think it is there. I think it'll be more in the future, because I think investors, they will not put their money in if they don't have a solid documentation of the sustainability, because the consumers will demand that there is a documentation, and if they can't provide it, then they're not going to use the product, and then why develop it? Like you know, developments, they have an economical feasibility, they maybe have a study on a technological feasibility, on the market feasibility, and there's going to be something about this sustainability more and more.
I believe so.
So I think it has come to stay.
Yeah, thank you very much, and I appreciate the time for the questions. And this brings us to the end of the Q&A session, and I hand over back to Amasha.
Thank you very much, Professor Abbas. Thank you very much, everyone. So this is the end of the 8th session of the Global Lecture Series. So I would like to extend my sincere gratitude and appreciation to Professor Christiansen for your valuable contribution and for sharing your knowledge with us during your busy schedules. And I also extend my special thanks to Professor Yongsik Ok for organizing this great event. Thank you very much, Professor Abbas, for your time and for the wonderful coordination. And thank you very much, every panelist, the program leader, and all the participants for attending this event and bringing your expertise to this gathering. And thank you again, and have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye for now.
Ciao, ciao.
Thank you. Bye-bye.